welcome to season four of the SWN podcast. Yes, we've made it to season four. That's like more than The Office UK, pretty much any UK TV show, and we're still going. The ratings are fine. But I'm here, season four of the SWN podcast, and I am joined by a terrifying duo. That's what I've been described as what they are through the Twitter sphere. I'm joined by the Struthers sisters, Maven and Raven. Welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you for having us.
So I'm really only dealing with what I've seen on the interweb, on the internet. I'm apologize. I don't know. I can't tell you the part because Maven and Raven and your profile pictures are even more confusing because both of you. So I'm just like, I'm guessing who they are. But so if you want to introduce yourself, tell us a little bit. Sure. Tell us a little bit about yourselves.
I am Maven Struthers. I am the big little sister, I guess. And this is Raven. We should have maybe sat the other way around, given that it says Maven and Raven on the screen, but this was my good side, so yeah. We went with this.
Sorry, the names doesn't pop up, so that's absolutely fine. But it's like an Ant and Dec thing. You like make sure just people know the order.
I don't think it matters.
It just happens naturally, and people will get us confused, so we'll get called each other's names, and it's fine.
Yeah, whatever happens, you know, you're going to be treated the same way by either of us, so it's fine.
In the Ant and Dec world, it was, of course, they all stand the same way. Me and my wife apparently do the same, which has been affectionately been titled Dick and Ant, which I didn't enjoy. When I got told that was the order that I apparently stand in. Anyway, season four of the SWN podcast. This is episode 125, I think. That's including the Christmas special, of course, that I recorded last night, which was ridiculous if people have listened to it already. But the question's always the same. The first one, break the ice as we get onto this wrestling chat. What got you into pro wrestling? What was the moment that got you hooked?
In terms of watching wrestling, or in terms of
in
terms of watching wrestling, 1989 maybe I started watching wrestling, and the colours and the characters and everything. And then we hit 1990 and The Undertaker comes on the scene, and I was like, yeah, this guy is everything. He speaks to me on a very deep level. He speaks to my soul. And I guess I went on my journey with his career. And it's, I guess, a wee bit ironic that we are now making a jump into actually doing wrestling, just as he comes to the end of his career. So I don't know, maybe it's a jumping off point for me. But yeah, The Undertaker definitely is the, I was interested in wrestling, but Undertaker hooked me and pulled me in. And yeah, echoes a lot of my personality, echoes a lot of my experiences, my likes, that sort of thing. So,
I was a wee bit later, like that. It was probably around 97, 98 I started watching wrestling. And I'm not going to say what got me watching it, because I get absolute pelters for it.
Oh, this is the place to share. It's a circle of trust, even though it's going to go out on the internet.
So, watching TV, not thinking about it, flicking through the channels, and it was SmackDown on Sky Sports 1. And I just breezed past it and kept going. And then I was like, it kind of caught my eye, and I was like, what was that? So I kind of flicked back, and I knew a bit about wrestling because my uncle used to watch it when I was younger. But by that point, I didn't really, it wasn't my thing. And I flicked back, and it was The Rock doing a promo. And I just started watching it, and I never stopped. And I don't think you knew that's what it was that I started watching it on.
I discovered that very recently, and I'll be honest, man, I lost a little bit of respect.
Yeah. and that's kind of what got me started. And then I just, once I started watching, I just didn't stop, just kept watching it.
Well, I thought when you said it was going to give repellents, I thought you were going to flick on it was Rikishi giving someone a stink face. You thought, oh, can we continue watching this? Or I don't know what happened. It could have been Val Venus getting his dick chopped off. It could have been anything. And I thought the rock's fine. Yeah. That's not so bad. I mean, I started watching when my first experience was the Inferno match between Undertaker and Kane. And
yeah.
And, you know, it's not a great time to go in as an 8-year-old watching it because it was quite scary. seeing a man on fire and then Vince McMahon or just an old man on the floor crying that teddy bear's on fire. That's an introduction to wrestling that an 8-year-old doesn't need. But I was that's it. It's been there since I'm 31 now and I'm still watching wrestling.
Yeah, I got you hooked.
Baptism
by fire. There you go. So favorites growing up then, of course you've already mentioned The Undertaker being one. What was your other kind of favourites growing up?
You go first, then, to think about this. I was just one track mind, like Undertaker, let's do this.
Yeah, so growing up, my favourites were kind of Triple H, DX, and I quite liked like either the bad guy or the underdog, because I don't know, it's just the way it is. So like, you know, Crash Holly. Hardcore Holly, like I love Hardcore Holly, like he's one of my favourites. And his book's amazing, like it's such a good book.
Because he's genuinely tough, like he's just tough, he's just such a badass, and it just comes across in his mentality. I mean, you look at a lot of the politics and stuff that were going on, and a lot of the kind of behind the scenes, like it's that he just wasn't taking it for anybody, and you're like, yes, sir, like that's an archetype for us,
And then things like the APA and stuff like that. So like probably quite a varied
dudes batting folk is what you like to just do, and Crash Holly. Harker Holly, but yeah, he's an absolute favourite. I was thankful I got to meet him once at a show and got his book signed. And my favourite story ever of Harker Holly is him being asked what where do you want your character to go? What do you want to do? And he just replied going, I want to beat everyone, then win the title, and then beat everyone.
Yeah.
I mean, if you ask a stupid question, you're going to get an answer that's like, I want to win all the time.
He just cuts it all out. I know. Straight to the point, does what it says in the tin. Like, when you were talking there, I was thinking, I kind of went for a lot of the kind of darker characters, but still, like, the bad guys, because it was that no-nonsense. Just do it. Just do, you know, take what you want, give nothing back. Just have at it and don't apologise. And I think that's, although I kind of went maybe the darker or the more gothic route rather than just the smash and bash them, there's definitely a common theme there, isn't there?
Yeah.
Ministry of Darkness is your your jam then, with of course Acolytes and Midian.
Midian, good times.
It's a time. I think it's a time of its age. You know, I think if they did it now, even though people are all clamoring, bring back the Arch era, no, because there's a lot of good stuff. There's a lot of stuff you can't do in 2020. It'll also be 2022 when this goes out. There's a lot of stuff you can't do in 2022. Like we've already mentioned, Val Venus getting his dick chopped off. So you got to balance it a little bit.
I think, but there's definitely a space for the same sort of intense attitude, but just kind of done in a more, I don't know, more up-to-date way. And I think you see wee glimmers of it sometimes coming through, and I think it's something we will see more of. It's like, you know, with the I've been saying for years that I think that wrestling's far too overexposed, and one of the things that's caused that is like the need to generate content for things like the network and everything. And so it kind of it just opened the doors in a lot of ways. Like, and so at what point, you know, can somebody like The Undertaker maintain their mystique and maintain their air of authority? Or, you know, somebody like Dean Ambrose, John Moxley, at dinner with his wife at the Bella's house, you know, and it took a wee bit of the edge off. And I think it's finding how you can maintain balance that strength of character. But obviously the internet and the freedom of what people can access and all the different sides of your life that they can see, you know, it's like, it's striking the balance. And I think Bob Holly was doing that a long time ago, like he was nailing that a long time ago.
Absolutely, because I mean, think about it. If you had an Undertaker character now, the first thing some, and I am one, so I think I can make fun of them. Some dork will just go onto the internet and find Mean Mark Calloway and his big ginger, and his waistcoat and his red trunks and his one glove, and think, oh, you can't take the Undertaker seriously because I've seen Mean Mark Calloway, and look at that, look at that guy. I think for a lot of detractors of it, I think NXT 2.0 is as close as a modern day representation as we can get, because they have big characters. It's a bit chaotic, and you've got these big dudes battering folk like Bron Breakker, who's an absolute favourite of mine since he came onto the scene. Even though it's not the like trash TV, Jerry Springer kind of TV,
I think
that's as close as we're going to get in a modern setting with it. And, I mean, you say AEWs and what have, but it didn't have as many like fourth wall breaking in the Attitude Era. It was just look at these mental characters, they're going nuts for 2 hours on a Monday. Love it. So how did you go from, so the 10-year gap then of wrestling, so when you found out that you're now both watching wrestling, was it just all full steam ahead, like, yeah, we're gonna watch this, we're gonna watch pay-per-views, we're gonna tape this off Sky? What was that kind of moment where you realized that we're both watching wrestling now?
I told this story at Raven's wedding, but I thought I was the only girl in the world that watched wrestling growing up in the Attitude Era, bar the women that you saw on the TV. And they were very different from me, you know, and they were, you know, fitness models, or they were models or whatever. And that wasn't really what I was into wrestling for. Like, I like the violence, and I like the fighting, and I like the strong characters. And so I never really, the women were never really echoed with me. So I thought, I felt very alone, very isolated. And I was in school one day, and I heard this boy talking to this other lassie about wrestling. And I was like, she must watch wrestling as well. This is dead weird. And I cornered her in the corridor, and I said, do you watch the wrestling? And she was alarmed, and I think she thought it was maybe going to batter her or make fun of her or whatever. And she very timidly kind of went, yeah, I was like, me too. And that was it, wasn't it? It was like love at first sight, best friends, pay-per-views, indie shows, swapping magazines, posters, like full works.
Anything you could get your hands on, and, you know, sitting at like, what, 16, making plans, like, we're going to WrestleMania, this is it, 21st birthday, that'll be us.
I was even 16, 14 probably.
And that was it, like.
And we did it. We went to WrestleMania for our 21st, and I think everybody just thought, pie in the sky, nonsense, it'll pass. I remember my grand saying, you know, you can't let this wrestling thing take over your life. You know, you need to have a social.
Too late.
She's like, you need to have a social life, and I was like, it is my social life.
Social life.
And we done it, it stuck. And I don't know if we would have been friends without wrestling. You know, it's like a big part of our relationship and our friendship. That's 20 years we've been best friends, closer than sisters.
That's the thing. When wrestling, I think we've all went through the same. I've definitely had the it's just a phase. You'll grow out of it, and here I am. But now we've got a podcast doing it, speaking about it. So everyone thinks that wrestling is just a phase of your life. You want to see these things, and I suppose it is a bit more difficult for women because again, most of the wrestling fan base is sweaty dudes in their basement. I mean, I'm upstairs, thankfully, but the sweaty dudes in their basement. And the first thing you're going to get asked by any guy, I'm going to guess, will be if you say you like the wrestling, you're going to have to prove it. You're going to have to name 5 WWE champions. You're going to have to tell someone who did CM Punk beat to set off his 434-day title reign, or some absolute nerdy crap that'll come up. It is nice that you've actually found someone that's, again, female, that likes wrestling, so you don't have to deal with that. You just get cornered and be asked if do you like the wrestling, which is always there's a terrifying prospect.
There's a lot of stigma, though, like, you know, when we were younger, for some reason there would be an assumption that we were gay or, you know, whatever. And I think that it's not great, but the wrestling community is getting better at accepting the diversity and inclusion of all walks of life. But that just kind of, those assumptions and those walls and barriers that, you know, you face, that it, you can't just be a woman that likes wrestling, or you can't, you know, you can't just be whatever you are in your personal life. And then, you know, it was like, it echoed through. It was strange, wasn't it? And I think so, for that reason, we have a big place in our hearts for diversity and inclusion in wrestling, which is ironic because, you know, we do just want to beat people up. But at the same time, we're like, we'll beat anybody up, you know. But I think having gone through that experience of being stigmatised or being treated as the other in the wrestling community and having to justify your place there, you know, and there was a point. And I mean, in 1998, I could tell you heights, weights, hometowns, finishing moves, like unbeaten record. But probably for that reason, I had to justify my place. You know, I had to be like, actually, I know more than you know. And as I got older, that kind of fell away because it became more about my personal experience with wrestling and what it meant to me, and not having to justify that. And so, you know, now having a space in the wrestling community and being renegade and everything, and being able to make it a space where, no, everybody's welcome to be battled by the Struthers Sisters. Like, we don't care what background you're coming from. But that was, I don't know if you had the same sort of vibe of that.
No, definitely. And, you know, even your opinions on, you know, who you liked, who you didn't like, it was always, oh, you just like them because, you know, they're attractive or X, Y, Z. And no, it's not that. Like, I can watch wrestling and appreciate it for wrestling, like, end of story. Like, but you did have to pretty much justify everything as a woman, like, especially when we were growing up. Obviously, it's, like you were saying, the community is getting better. Like, there is a lot more women at shows and things like that. But
people in the LGBT community, like different races, different abilities, like so much more diverse. But
when we were kind of going to shows when we first became friends and stuff, and you know, it was like, go meet your dad and go meet your mum, the only girls there were with their brother, because their brother wanted to see the wrestling, or it was mums, because they were taking their kids and stuff like that.
Or it was the female talent, but it was the valets, the managers, you know. And very occasionally you would see, and there was, you know, there was lots of great badass women going about, but you just wouldn't, it wasn't freely available, you know, you couldn't find it. And I think that echoes a bit in our approach of, like, you know, we're not here to have the pretty hair and the pretty makeup and be models. We're here to beat people up. We're here to be tough. Yeah, we're here to wrestle, and that comes first, you know. And all the other stuff is aside. No, you know, if you happen to look good doing it, that's great, but that's not the view. And I hope that if we can echo that continually, like through anything that we do, and people look at us and go, "Hey, that's what I want to be. I want to be tough, or I want to be strong, or I want to be well." Doesn't matter, you know what. Race, religion, sexual identity, gender identity, like whatever, you know, it doesn't matter how they fit into the world, they've got a place here. So I don't know, we're a bit of a dichotomy in a way that, in, you know, on one hand we're like, we just want to beat you up, but we want to beat everybody up, you know, everybody's welcome here.
That's the thing. You're definitely right when you're saying that wrestling is becoming more inclusive. Of course, you do have the obviously the small pocket of idiots, but that pocket's getting smaller, I'd like to think. And eventually, we're all just going to be calling it wrestling. It's not. I'm always, because I've watched that for so long, I do get into the habit of female wrestling, men's wrestling, but I always try consciously just call it wrestling now, because that's what it is. I'm just watching some wrestling. I don't care. I don't particularly care who's in the ring, because it's my escape from the big scary world of real life and bills and like getting windows fitted and all this sort of like grown-up stuff, when I could just like go, right, I'm feeling a bit overwhelmed by life, I'm gonna watch a Jeff Hardy match, which of course, as of recording, he's just been released with WWE, but he's always going to be my favourite. So I'll watch a Jeff Hardy match, or I'll watch a Wrestle, I'll watch a Rumble. Rumbles always help. Oh. Rumbles are the best.
Rumbles are my favourite. Like, you cannot beat a Rumble in wrestling. Like, if there's a Rumble, I'm watching it.
I think that was one of the great things about when one of the first AEW shows that kind of got us hooked, because we'd fallen away from the WWE for a long time, just sick of the cookie cutter approach, and the, you know, particularly with the kind of the talent that we were looking at, or, you know, trying to build in ourselves, like, you know, your big tough women or whatever, like, it just got very same, and we fell away from it for a long, long time. And one of the things that kind of hooked us in with AEW was one of the Rumble matches, and it was just like so diverse, like so many different people coming in, and people you didn't really know, or hadn't heard of in a long time, or had heard of but hadn't seen much of, and things like that. And it was just, yeah, it was like, it was such a great chance that, you know, that they come in and they've got that 10, 15 seconds to just do something that catches your eye, and then you can follow it. It's like a buffet, do you know what I mean? Like, yeah. They'll do something that catches your eye and you go, well, that's all right, I'm going to look them up later, I'm going to watch some of their stuff later. That's how I like about Rumble. Yeah. It's like a wee insight into who this person might be.
I love a buffet, so
yeah, I love a buffet as well, when you mention it.
Rumbles are. I think if you mention any fan, if they don't like a Royal Rumble, then I don't think you don't need that negativity in your life. That's just
no, the worst thing.
That's what it is. I mean, that's how I introduced my wife to it, because I was like, we're going to the Rumble because the Rumble's the best. You'll love it. It's very easy to understand. You throw over the top rope, both feet hit the ground. That's it. That's all you need to know. And afterwards, she was like, right. I'll go to the Rumble again. It doesn't matter what. Like, I might go to this show, I might go to that show, but if I tell her there's a Rumble on, she is going to that show because she's like,
Rumbles. You know, I learned something about Rumbles recently. I was doing some research about tag wrestling, and I learned that the reason the Rumble match is so special is because, like, normally in a match, to throw your opponent over the top rope would be a disqualification for you. So if I just picked you up and threw you out the ring, I would get disqualified. You're not allowed to do that. And so the Rumble match was special because
it allowed you
to throw them over the top rope. And I guess maybe allowed the bigger guys to showcase some of the stuff that they could do. So I've not really went back and looked at how that developed over time. Yeah. Like, do you know how wrestling changed once that was introduced? That, you know, at what point did they just start going, you can just throw them over the top rope? But I thought that was interesting that was what made a Rumble match a hook in the first place.
Yeah, it used to be, it was definitely an old NWA WCW rule, but I remember in WWF, I remember, obviously I wasn't there at the time, but the Berserker would lose all his matches because he would just throw his opponent over the top rope and get disqualified. That was his finisher. It was very weird, but you know, it was what, 90, I'm going to guess 93 or something like that, and it was a very weird time in 1993 for wrestling, as you look back on it. So, of course, you became, we'll speak about how you became wrestlers and how you got to training, but were you aware of any of the Scottish wrestling scene at all before you started training?
Yes. Like, we started going to shows in our teens.
98.
And
10th of April 1998 was the first show that we went to together.
It was still, I don't know if you'll remember, like, when they used to, like, emulate the WWE, so you would have The Undertaker and Kane and whoever else all as the different characters. So we started going to those kind of shows in 98. I mean, and
it's insane, though. Like, I was talking to Aisha Raymond about this the other day. Like, we saw Fit Finlay at one of those shows. Like, and you didn't realise at the time, because we were too young. You know, wrestling was just wrestling. We were too young to really be that in the know, and, you know, there wasn't that much access to the internet and things like that at the time. You know, it was like if you're sitting in the school library or something trying to, like, dial up. But, you know, thinking back now, I'm like, that was Fit Finlay, that's who that was. Or, you know, like, other big names that are now, you know, synonymous with Scottish wrestling or synonymous with international wrestling, and you're like, they were just there in the Paisley Town Hall, like, casual, like. So yeah, we did a lot of that.
And it kind of started there and then just developed into the different companies. So, I mean, it's in kind of West Central Scotland, like, I don't think there's probably a company that we haven't been to see as fans.
Yeah, I mean, we still travel, like, I mean, adults, we expend more income now. So, like, we travel, you know, we've been down to Manchester, Liverpool, Norwich, we've been out to WrestleMania a whole bunch of times. We've tried to catch things in other places. We were over in Hungary and we tried to catch some stuff there, but I think we missed it by a week or something.
But
I mean, we'll go, like, we'll go to Olympic wrestling if it's available.
Yeah.
Like,
if there's tickets available, we'll try and get to it.
I'm just thinking, yeah, tribute show. I only ever went to the one because I've said this story many times on the podcast, but it's a new season, so I can tell it again. Yeah, it was 2001 was the only time I've been to a tribute show, and it was a Mankind. It's the only one I remember. It was Mankind, and it was just a fat guy with long hair and a shirt. That was pretty much it. So you've seen, when you're talking about those guys, I mean, you said Fit Finlay. I'm sure Robbie Brookside was on tons of those kind of shows, and he's now training at NXT. That I think the actual NXT, not the NXT UK. So, and you would probably see probably seen Johnny Saint or Johnny Kidd or all these guys that are synonymous with British wrestling, and there they are in the same card as DX. Which is a guy dressed as X-Pac, was it? There's a Rock one. I can't remember his character name, but it was Rocky something. And then you get Fit Finlay just coming in and with his mullet. Yeah. I'm assuming he has his mullet at that point, but for his Belfast Bruiser days. So you would have seen. So you've seen the kind of evolution of Scottish wrestling in general, because. Mm-hmm. I came in at 2012, and it was just before its big proper boom period. So I didn't get to see these shows and with 20 people turning up and that.
I mean, we were saying the other day, we were at a show in Kilwinning, and Viper, Nikki Storm at the time, and Big Demo were all on the show, and there was 12 people in the audience. Well, there was 10 plus us.
10 plus us.
In the audience. Some of the best shows I've ever been to are shows like that, because they just put it out there, because, you know, it's a great time. You've got a live audience that you can work with, but if anything goes wrong, nobody's going to know, apart from this guy who remembers it 10 years later. Yeah. But, you know, like the... It's what I call like church hall wrestling, and I think to myself, like sometimes I think, God, if those walls could talk, some of the absolutely legendary matches that they'll have seen come and go that were never even recorded on a phone or something like that, like, and they're just lost to the void, and the only people that will know that that was an amazing match are the wrestlers themselves, if they were even aware of how good it was. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's insane. But we were there in the, I don't know, the Neolithic of the Mesolithic of the Scottish wrestling scene.
You do hear madness of like Yokozuna was doing a tour. It was doing tours around about there.
Met him and Irvin at the Magnum, and
Jake Roberts as well. He would be kicking about. He lived there.
Met him in Linwood Sports Centre. Yeah, it was a cancelled tour. Jake was having personal issues, and then they rescheduled it, and he was there. I mean, it's like, it's insane. It's absolutely insane. Mm-hmm. You know, these guys, and I always think, like, the rest of the world, you know, it's like, I don't know, the Harry Potter, like, muggle thing. Do you know, the muggles are going about their life, and you're in Linwood Sports Centre like that. That's Jake Roberts right in front of me. It's insane.
Or the Kilmarnock Town Hall, and you're like, I am so close to Kevin Nash that I could touch him from a balcony, because... he's so tall, the place is so small, and it's just amazing.
Yeah, it's not, it's like, it's just, I don't know, it's intangible, do you know what I mean? You can't record it, it's just moments in history, but it's wild. Like, we were at the Drew, correct me here if I'm wrong, right? Drew McIntyre, is that what, yeah.
Yes.
So that's what it is now, yeah.
Yeah, Drew Galloway's last match in Scotland. And you know that way at the time, you're like, right, good luck, big stuff, right, off you go, see you later. And now you're like, oh, okay, yeah, you did that, like, that was amazing. And it's I don't know, it's living history, isn't it? Mm-hmm. You don't realise at the time that this is a pure moment. And we were like, you know, wish them all the best, off you go, like, you know, you do you. And then, you know, you think back to that moment and you're like, wow, like...
That was a big thing.
That was a huge moment. A huge moment for Scottish wrestling as well, I think, in a way, because we were kind of taking on the journey. And that beautiful moment, like, when he won at WrestleMania, and he's, like, reaching out to the camera, and I was like, aye, that's me. That's you're reaching out in the Magnum and Irvine to that last match you had here. Like, it was emotional, wasn't it? It was a pure moment.
I love that muggle analogy when you speak about that, because, because I've been lucky enough to meet quite a lot of wrestlers in my time doing, not just doing this, being a nerd and going to wrestling shows. But I was driving Colt Cabana and Sanjay Dutt to a show, and we had to stop in Elgin, where I live. because Colt needed to get data on his wee three-bar thing, which is a very boring part of the story, but it's important. So we stopped there, stopped at the Giles Centre, went in, and they were hungry, so I thought, oh, we'll go to Subway. Subway's downstairs. So here I am, standing in a Subway queue with Sanjay Dutt and Colt Cabana, ordering Subways, and I'm just sitting, looking around, folk going, no one else is seeing this. This is Sanjay Dutt and Colt Cabana here. They're ordering Subway. Colt is now arguing with the guy that he shouldn't pay 5p for a bag. Is no one not seeing this?
You're like, hello, what's happening?
You don't want to go. I don't want to get them swarmed or anything. But at the same time, you're like going, look what's happening. Look who's here. Say something to them.
Where would it have been? Miami. We were in the airport. Just like sitting waiting for the flight home. Daniel Bryan walks by, Brian Danielson, whatever. I'm dyslexic. I'm like, I can't keep up, right? But Daniel Danielson walks by and just, you know, you're like, okay. And everybody's going about their business and you're like, no. Like, what, he's eating fried chicken. and it's like that weird, like, you know, that weird moment of like when you show people, I always take like panoramas and stuff at WrestleMania and you show people that don't know anything about wrestling and they're like, wow, and you're like, yeah, there's a whole world
you don't know about,
and it's like, and it's a massive part of your world, you know. And then for them, it's just this, you give them a wee insight, and they're like, oh, and they'll talk about it, you know. Like, remember at one WrestleMania when Shane gets thrown off the cage, mm-hmm. and I filmed it, and so when people say to me, oh, you're wrestling, blah, 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 and you show them that, and it's just this huge spectacle, and this guy flying off a cage, and we were all right, first tier, maybe seats. But you can actually see it in the video, you can see him fly, and you're like, yeah, that's a wee insight, isn't it? What's going on that you've got no clue about?
No idea.
it's a wonderful, weird world. I mean, obviously, stuff does happen where it seems to impact you more than anything else. Of course, last year, a lot of stuff happened, and the whole community was kind of downhearted about it. Sorry, not last year, because we're in 2022. 2 years ago. Stuff happened, and It's the same case of like, yeah, nobody understands. But if you're in the community, you're like going, oh, this is the worst thing ever. And folk from outside are going, no, that's a bad thing. But oh well. And you're like going, yeah. No, this is taking away people that I like, or finding out things about people I like that now I don't like them, kind of thing. And here we are.
That philosophical kind of question about like, can you separate the art for the artist? Mm-hmm. You know, and like, can you still enjoy their match or their work when you find something out that's, it may be, you know, it might be just downright illegal, or it might just go against your kind of moral compass, and it's like trying to negotiate, that's difficult, like, isn't it? And I think as well, like, you know, I remember there was a phase where, you know, you reach a certain age in life and you start to hear, oh, this person's died or that person's died, and it becomes more frequent. And there was a period where we'd be like, you know, somebody would be like, oh, such and such a wrestler's dead, and you're like, please don't be drugs, please don't be drugs, please don't be drugs, do you know? And it's sad, but I mean, after our very first training session, I remember saying to anybody that would listen, I will never judge any wrestler for being addicted to pain medication, because I'd only done a tiny little sliver of what they would probably do in a training session, and I was like, I could not feel like this every day of my life, like, and you know, you see how it happens, but with the same token, you're like, we need to try and do better, give better support, like get people to a better place. Like, it's a, you know, it's a different time, isn't it? Things are changing.
Yeah, I'm exact same. Even I mean, if you go, oh, they're over 70, I'm thinking, oh, thank God. That's a good innings for a wrestler anyway. 70.
It's crazy.
But and then when you go, it's like was it Eddie Guerrero's 35, and you're just like going, oh, that's not a life. Especially now, I'm 4 years away from it, and I think I'm not grown up enough to consider myself like grown up at 35, let alone pass like that. And it's just wrestling world is, yeah, it's as much as we love it and we use it as escapism, when you start overthinking it, you think, God, it's not nice. It's not a nice world. It's just you kind of.
It's a thing though. It's like, I think it's in your blood, isn't it? Like, I just very much feel like, see, when I watched the film The Wrestler, I was just like, yeah, I get this. Like, I get it 100%. And, you know, sometimes you try to explain it to people that are not into it, and I'm like, you either get it or you don't. Yeah. You know, it either hits you in that level. Like, you know, like watching the film The Wrestler, that was only ending one way. You knew it was only ending one way. You knew from the start that's how it was going. And you're like, it's a hard thing. Like, it's, I guess in itself, it's a bit of an addiction, and it's just, it's just balancing it, you know, because it's like, you, and then it becomes so consuming in your life that you're like, right, I just need to keep going. One more bit, one more bump. Like, aye.
No, The Wrestler's a fantastic film. It's not a nice film by any stretch
of the imagination. It's uncomfortable. But I think it's a great thing to show people that don't get it, don't understand it, you know, and I think it goes into the psychology of, like, the mindset that people get themselves into really well. Like, aye, happy days.
So let's move on to happier things. What made you decide to, at this point, to go, right, I've watched it for years, I love this wrestling stuff, I've seen it everywhere, I'm going to give it a go myself. So how did you get to that point?
I got sick and tired of watching the same sorry ass soft work. And I was like, nah. I've got something to offer here. I want to be big, bad, I want to own it, and I just want to destroy anybody that stands in my way, because I am sick of watching this soft ass work and people praising it, you know, people being like, oh yeah, that was so great, that was no. And I just felt like I had something to offer and we had something to offer, you know, particularly, you know, we are trying to move away from this idea like women's wrestling, but like, you know, women don't need to be skinny, flippy, spandex, big fluffy hair. Like, it doesn't need to be that. It shouldn't be that. That's not what it is. And, you know, one of the things that really grated my nerves about the WWE was I felt at one point the women were a hair colour and fancy ring wear. And I was like, this is what the men were doing in the 80s. Like, strip all that back. You know, the Stone Cold route, black trunks, black knee pads, you know, whatever, get out there and get your business handled and show people like you're staking a claim. And so I was just like, I'm done, I'm actually done, and I'm going to put all this anger and all this rage that I have about this into making a difference and making a change, or at least standing in the way, because if you want to do all your flip-floppy gymnastics and spinny, fancy, shiny skirts, Katsabella, then you're going to have to go through me first, because if you want to step in the ring and you want to do it, then you're going to have to get me out of your way. And I found a tag team partner that had a similar mentality.
Yeah, so. And there was definitely, from what we were seeing, there was definitely an underrepresentation of people like us.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if and even when there were, you know, like your Tamina Snookers and things like that, they were very easily beaten by tiny women, and it was just like,
you would sit and get angry, you'd watch it and you'd get angry and you'd be like, I'm not sitting here watching this tiny wee woman that I could snap over my leg in a heartbeat, I could snap her like a match, trying to beat this woman and being cheered for it. Are you crazy? Like, this is mental. No, we're done with that, we're done.
But as well as that, I'm trying to think of names that you guys would have seen at the time, Bertha Faye, Nicole Bass, like all these bigger women, but they were treated like freaks because they weren't the norm, I suppose, that you could put. Even you had like Jacqueline, who was kind of the same kind of figure as everyone else, but because she was muscly and no nonsense and a bit of a bruiser, she would just batter you. She was treated as like an afterthought as well because of that. So I suppose when you see Scottish wrestling, you saw like a Viper. Was she one that was like, that's my kind of wrestling that I want to see? Just her coming in, battering folk, no nonsense. She didn't, and don't use the phrase, not like most girls, but she was not like most girls as a wrestler. Was she one that you kind of gravitated to?
We went to school with her, and she kind of, we didn't realise at the time, it was only after the fact, because we were a wee tiny bit older than her, but just a wee tiny bit, but when we saw her, we were like, she's prioritising wrestling and everything else comes after that, you know, where, you know, she's got lovely hair and, you know, beautiful makeup and, you know, nice ring wear and all that stuff. But that's all secondary to what she goes into the ring to do. And you're like, yes, A thousand times, yes. And you know, there's various women that have come out of Scottish wrestling that are the same, you know, like Kayleigh Ray and people like that, where you're like, I mean, there's not very many people that I wouldn't go ahead with, but these women are among them, mm-hmm. you know, because I'm like, you are doing it, you are representing us, but there's just not enough. Mm-hmm. There's not enough, and it's not acceptable. And so we are filling a gap, and specifically filling the gap in terms of tag team wrestling, you know, and we keep saying we are a career tag team, you know, we're not two lashes that been stuck together to, you know, try and get more women on the card, or, you know, if we've got one women's match but it's a tag match, then we get four women. No, like, we're here to do this as a tag match, and we'll go through any tag teams that kind of want to face us, or any people that are put together as a tag team that want to face us. But, you know, if we're run out of women, we'll quite happily fight the men as well, or any of the in between for that matter. Like, we're not pigeonholing ourselves. But
it's definitely a big thing that is missing. Like, you very rarely see women in a tag team that are a tag team, that aren't just, they've been put together for a match, or in the next week, you know, they'll be back to singles wrestling and stuff. Like, that was a kind of a big thing that we set out straight away. Like, yeah, we are a package deal, clearly. Can't tell us apart.
Definitely been was phased out at point, because I think when I started watching, you had Glamour Gym and She-X. That was it. That was, I think, as far as, oh, and the Owens. Can't forget the Owens. The Owen twins as well. And that was it when it came to if you're a tag team. But even then, they weren't a career tag team. They, mm-hmm. 1 week you'd have Viper and Bete Noire teaming as She-X, and then the next week they'd be fighting as Viper and Bete Noire, and then you'd have, of course, Glamour Gym as well, Carmel and now Serena Rose. So, yeah, there's no, I'm trying to think of any, I mean, there's ones hanging about. You've got Angel Hayes and Rosie Knight, I suppose. They tag team quite a bit, but again, at the same time, they also wrestle each other. So, you've kind of got the Edge and Christian initial mentality of you're coming in as a tag team, that's your plans, that's your goal, tag team.
That's Christian.
Fine.
You say that Edge was a more successful one. I'm just saying.
Right, how'd you switch this off?
so you had that of yeah. There is, I can't think of any other tag teams that are going about, and I know that as soon as I turn this off, I'll think of a tag team that's going about. But when it came to so at least when you came into training, both of you started at the same time. Then you're able to kind of support each other. Through this, was there any moments where one turned to the other and were like, "No, this is, I'm fine. I've tried, and I'll just to go ahead."
Every second of every training session that we have ever done, we will turn to each other and go,
"I think I've got work. It's time to go."
We're not, you know, you're not really getting the kind of full image here, but we're not exactly the most svelte or the most athletic. We enjoy things like carbohydrates, buffets, fizzy juice.
Full fat iron brew.
I mean, training's tough.
It's very hard.
Our very first training session, it was Big Demo was the regular trainer, and Paul Tracy was in doing a seminar, and Big Demo thought in his wisdom that he would just get Paul Tracy to warm everybody up, and Paul Tracy wanted us to do like one exercise for like every person in the room, and there was 27 people in the room, and so people would choose sit-ups, push-ups, whatever, blah blah blah, and we had to do 10 per person. So that was 270 squats, 270 sit-ups, 270 whatever other torturous devices that they had for us. And I went blind, and I remember leaning against the wall, not sure if I was going to pass out or be sick, thinking, that's me, I'm blind, you know, my wrestling career has only started and it's over. And I remember somebody patting me on the head and saying, you picked a hell of a first day. And I was like, yeah,
well. And the next day, could not walk.
Literally couldn't walk.
It was, I have never been in such pain. It was insanity, like trying to get in and out of a car, trying to sit down on the sofa.
Mm-hmm. But that was the day where we were like, I will never hold it against any wrestler to be addicted to pain medication. But we smartened stuff up and we ate some soup. And we went back again the following week for it.
But every session is hard. And it's one of those things where we're like, yep, time to go. But you just push on and work at it. And yeah. I think we keep each other going. We are very competitive, probably the most insanely competitive people you will ever meet. Like, I mean, I have competitions with people who don't know I'm having a competition, like on the street walking faster than someone. Like, I'm like, I'm going to overtake you, and you don't know I'm going to overtake you. You don't even know I exist, but I'm overtaking you. So we kind of push each other and
that the other people at Renegade as well, like it's such a community, like it's such a great atmosphere, you know. And I remember Aisha Raymond doing drills with us where we were literally dragging ourselves across the mats on our elbows and not using our legs, and your elbows are scuffed and you know, sore and bleeding in some cases. I cried, like I'm a regular person who admit it, I cried, but I kept going. And you know, there's your tag team partner's cheering you on, and then next to your tag team partner is that Kat Sabella, who has been talking crap about you and wants a match with you, and then along from her is Brody Adler, who's out there killing it and who I've got business with that we'll discuss later. And you know, she's out there killing it, and then the next person along is Cassie King, and you know, these people are all fighting for a spot on the show that you're going to be on, because it's our show, like, you know, when we're taking up the space. And so you keep going in the spirit of competition, but you know, you're being driven along by your tag team partner, these other people, whatever. So it's tough stuff, you know. It's really tough. It doesn't, you know, athleticism does not come naturally to us. The only place we run is through the buffy line, but we're getting there.
Every week we say, nah, we're done, let's go, let's just go to McDonald's and never think about this again, and then every week we come back.
My knees are hurting just at the thought of 270 squats. I think that was enough for me, just mentally doing it.
Not worth it.
I think I'm quite happy just being at this side of the wrestling world. I'll just stick with that while you guys do the actual hard work. I'll write about it. That's the pen is my ear, then sword and all that kind of stuff. And my knees are okay afterwards. So was that so Damo and Paul Tracy then? So it would have been Source that you would have started with then, and then moved. Before you moved, before you started doing female classes, that'd be right.
So at the time, I think it was
SWA. SWA, the company, and like Source was the wrestling school, but they were attached to each other. I think
it was the one thing.
And then Source splintered off to just be the wrestling school, and then obviously doing their showcase shows and stuff. It was kind of the source banner, and it was before the women's only classes, and then Nikki started taking some of the women's only classes, and we went to a couple of them, but you know, Nikki's tiny and the other girls that were there are tiny, and you know, and I'm like, well, I remember doing Suplex Hell, where you learn how to deliver like a good snappy suplex to mess your opponent up. And they put us in the line of like size order, you know, so the biggest guy, and biggest being weight and height, you know, so you kind of just have your big skinny dudes, you know, there. And all the girls are like at one end, and then we're in the middle with all these guys. And so I'm like, well, you know, going to these girls' classes and wrestling with people that are 6 stone, 7 stone, you know, it's how I'm working with them versus how I'd work with Raven, or how I'd work with Aisha Raymond, you know, it was different. And so I don't really know how much we got from those classes in terms of it was a very homogenous demographic. There you go, right? It was a very homogenous demographic, you know, and one of the strengths of Renegade is that it's so much more diverse in terms of, you know, build and aims and things, you know, like Aisha Raymond really drills it into us about, like, you know, who are you? What are you doing here? What are you wanting to achieve? What's your style? You know, what's your artillery? Play to your strengths, you know, and then push yourself to do things that people won't expect somebody of your size or your ability to be able to do. So I don't really know how much I got out of those classes. Mm-hmm. But yeah. And then we had a bit of hiatus, and then I was working away and Laura was working away. I was working away and Raven was working away, and so I was up north, I was up your way actually, and Raven was down in London, so we just fell away from it completely for a while, and then we came back, and that was when it was like proper source. And Mikey Whiplash was the trainer, and that was interesting. That was a different approach, a different
dynamic.
Yeah, different dynamic. And you know, really good. I feel like Mikey Whiplash taught us a lot of really good habits, you know, and really good fundamentals. Which I think is what we're kind of jumping off of now, that Aisha Rehm is building on our, you know, basic fundamentals, you know, and we're not flipping about the place, but you know, we've got a really strong base and what we can achieve together. And then
we both got injured.
And so then, that was another hiatus.
Then COVID hit, and then Renegade, and it's been there ever since.
Yeah.
So not only a tag team in the ring, but you seem to be on the same kind of path with injuries and working away and all this stuff at the same time. I've spoken to Taisha in the past on this podcast, and we pretty much to discuss that, as she doesn't have to do what she does because she's over 6 foot, she's huge, she could just come in, giant Gonzalez them, batter them, and then leave, and then that's it. But she's went out of her way to learn British style, European, Japanese, because everything's part of this. You never know when you'll need one of these tools in your box, I suppose. And so it's definitely someone that's, who knows, can go, right, you're too like big girls, you're just going to do big girl stuff. But she'll turn around and go, you could do that.
I wish it was that easy.
And I was going to say, so Aisha's kind of turn around and go, you could do that, but we can do a bit of this as well.
One of the first moves that she taught us when we were working together was flying cross bodies. I was like, okay. And she was just like, I want you to be able to do things that people are going to look at you and expect you not to be able to do. Or, you know, she's like, I don't want you stomping about the ring, you know, and being like, oh, I'm big and heavy. And, you know, it's fair play, because we're not the biggest. We're maybe among the biggest at Renegade, but we're not the biggest across the board, you know. And so you do need to have that versatility that, you know, our match in November with the Renegade No Backup Required, I mean, I'm 16 stone and Katsabella's 6 stone, you know, and so that was a dynamic there. But just as easily I could be standing across the ring, or we could be standing across the ring from a pair of Aisha Raymonds, and then you know, we're back to zero, you know, we don't have that advantage, and so you need something else in your artillery. And so yeah, she's fantastic at that. And you know, she'll show you things, or she'll want you to try something, and if that doesn't work, you could try it like this, or if that doesn't work, you could try it like this. And you know, she's fantastic, and I'm sure you don't want to say it's effortless for her, because she's obviously put a lot of time and effort and work into getting to where she is, but she makes it look effortless. You know, she does things and you're like, I could train every day for the rest of my life, and I don't know if I'd ever be able to do that.
From today till the day I die, and I will never be able to do that if I practiced it every minute of every day. And she's just like, bah, 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 bah.
But also you're not allowed to say that, because if you say that, then she's like, oh, we're doing it.
I know.
But yeah, that's the pressure I got from her. She could have done all that kind of stuff, but she's quite in tune with just going, ah, but what if I do this? What if I could do that? And just does it. Well, doesn't just do it, practices it to a point where she's done it. And of course, she's now toured everywhere in Japan, just about, and been on TV and done all over Europe. And so
her credentials are insane. You know, it's one of those ones that's Fit Finlay in the Paisley Town Hall. You know, you're like, as if we get to go and be trained by this Amazon. Like, you know, and that's not just a moniker. Like, that is a statement of fact. Like, it is insane. But it makes you know, when you're crawling across the floor and your elbows are bleeding, or you're doing squats, you know, until you go blind and you can't walk, you keep going, because that's the person that's saying, no, that you've got more in you, you can go further with this, keep going, keep going, keep going. And she takes no prisoners, you know, in the best possible way. But yeah, it's motivation.
Yeah.
So it's always a case of if you're training with, getting taught by someone, you got to look at what they've done. It's all well good getting taught, do training, but if they've had two matches and both of which they got injured in. Why am I learning from you? Kind of thing. It's like you can't teach you can teach it. Those who can't do teach. Is that kind of moniker thing, but Aisha Raymond can do it. Sorry about that. But yeah, that old adage though that people throw about. So let's fast, because when you started that saying it was SWA, I was like, geez, you trained for a while. But then of course you mentioned the hiatus and COVID, and of course the COVID. Who can forget the COVID? So you're training with Aisha. When you find out about no backup required, so before the whole other mess that came with it, when you find out that no backup required was happening, were you told? Was it just a group meeting? When did you find out that you were actually getting in the ring?
So initially, there was a few different kind of permutations of what might happen, and it was, I think the way that we viewed it was, it's above our pay grade, you know, point is who you want us to batter and ring the bell. And so various things happened, that it was going to be this show or that show in this venue or that venue, there's going to be these people, there's not going to be these people. And so we didn't really have a solid plan for a long, long time. So we were just training with the mindset of, okay, you are going to be probably in a tag team match, but also you might not actually even get a match. And we were like, well, I mean, we're going to be there, so you better give us a match, otherwise you'll be paying the price for that. So we just kind of had in our head that it was happening and we didn't know what it would look like. And then just a wee bit of beef with Kat Sabella, and kind of, you know, I guess, you know, she's exceptionally talented, and, you know, she can carry herself and do things that, you know, legitimately I would never be able to do. But, you know, also I'm like, you kind of represent what it is that I want to just clothesline right out of wrestling in a lot of ways. And so she was kind of, I don't know, she's kind of fighting back for somebody that was quite small, and we kind of took exception to that. And so we'd kind of pushed for, oh, you know, maybe we'll just turn up and take up our business with Kat Sabella. And then London Loveless came on the scene, who was a kind of later addition to Renegade, and they took exception, I think.
They took exception
to our exception, aye. So, and then it just sort of naturally came together like that. And yeah, fine. Okay.
And that was it?
No.
Really, when I remember when I spoke to Brody, she mentioned London Lovelust, and was saying pretty much that they came in and were doing all these things, and Brody was looking back going, how dare you? How dare you be this talented so fast?
Yeah.
Just yeah. That kind of thing.
They're very athletic and very, what's the word? They're quite confident. Like, you know, there was things where, you know, we would hit them with the heart attack, or we would hit them with something, and I don't know, it was almost like they enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. I mean, but, you know, you'd be scraping them off the mat and they'd be like half a smile on their face. But yeah,
and I think their view on it is bump more, not less.
Bump more, not less, like getting about it. You know, so, but that's fine, you know, that's probably what Kat Sabella needed to back her up, but the business has not been set on time.
So. They'll learn after a couple of matches with you that bump less is better. Bump less is way better. So when it came to actually being the team, then, like you said, you always came in with the plan of being the team. And that was it. You're going to be whatever name, the Struthers Sisters, as you became known. What was the? Did you check out any particular tag team stuff? I mean, you said you used the heart attacks. So assuming there's some, I suppose the Anvil, Jim Neidhart is probably your kind of wrestler. Come in, batter folk, take and then
leave.
Yeah. Was there any other teams? You mentioned the APA before as well. Who are your kind of inspirations for your moveset and your style?
So there was one that kind of triggered us, that we watched and we were like, that's not watching us. And it was the Heavy Metal Sisters in the original Glow. And they just came in and just did them. They just took no prisoners, did exactly what they wanted. Most of their matches finishing a no contest or a disqualification or whatever. But they were, you know, they just threw people about and took up space. and staked a claim and then he apologised to anybody, you know, and if they had to use fire or whatever to do that, then, you know, whatever, you need to do what you need to do. And we were watching like, yeah, that's it. We, you know, where did they get lost in translation somewhere, you know, that mentality is kind of faded away. And yeah, that just, it spoke to us, didn't it?
Yeah, so you don't get tag teams like that really anymore. It was like,
so we were like, we want to kind of embody a bit of that chaotic energy in the sense of like, do you know, what are you going to do about it? Because if you want us to leave, you're going to have to make us leave. If you want us out of your ring, you're going to have to get us out your ring. And with the exception of maybe Aisha Raymond, there's nobody in Renegade Wrestling that I think is going to be able to get us out of that ring. And also on top of that, they'd need to separate us to do it. Mm-hmm. They'd need to, you know, they'd need to get in between us to do it. So we really liked them. Just now, I am loving FTR because they are just big strong boys doing big strong boy things, and I just like to think of us as big strong girls doing big strong girl things. And so, you know, I watch them work and they're so fluid, like they are, you know, in my mind that's a career tag team, the way they move, the way they interact, they know where the other guy's going before he goes there, you know, and they just move so well together, they interact so well together, the big hard hitting moves, like
It's like they are completely in sync, and that is us, like, you know, we don't have to talk to be able to say, right, this is what we're going to do, or this is what needs said, or whatever, like, even the simplest thing, it's like we are completely in sync, and that's the same.
And it's been a bone of contention with people, you know, for a long time, like, you know, a lot of our peers or people around the world, they don't like how in sync we are, they don't like the way we don't need to talk to communicate, maybe because they feel like we're talking about them without communicating, but the, you know, it's been a kind of a bone of contention with us in the past, and I think we're very much Marmite, you know, you either love us or hate us, and, you know, whatever, don't care. Yeah. Like, do we want?
Definitely, because, I mean, the number of times that we will say the exact same thing at the exact same time, no rehearsal required. And I think the word creepy gets bandied about a lot, or children of the corn, or stuff like that. Like,
I think
natural. And I think it's the same with them, like, watching them, they are a tag team.
Yeah.
They are together.
It's one unit.
Yeah.
One unit.
That's exactly it.
And two tertiary adjuncts, as they say. It's like two components in one unit. And I think a lot of the tag teams that we look at and that we like, they're the same. And so I've always kind of said, I like, I'm going to go for that word again, right? Dihomogenous tag teams, right? Like the New Age Outlaws, where they're different styles, they're doing different things, but they work well as a team. It just so happens that we are a homogenous tag team, you know, but like the likes of the LOD and people like that, you know, it's one entity, but with two different component parts. And that's the difference between what we're doing and what a lot of the people we're going to meet in the ring are doing. You know, they've put together one or a couple of nights, you know, and they're focused on their own career, and, you know, they're thinking about where they're going. Wherever we're going together. And that's it, you know. And I think sometimes Aisha seems to have a difference of opinion on that, but she'll learn.
Another one popped in my head, there was like a demolition, I suppose, would be the same.
Yeah,
beefy dudes just battering folk and that as well. Their attire was probably a bit questionable, but it was the 90s, so, you know.
Yeah.
It was a different time. I don't think you get away with it now, but it'd be fine.
It's not about your attire anyway, it's what's backing it up, so who cares?
But when we were discussing setting up this interview, of course, you mentioned there was some BBC filming, which, and I was like, oh, that's very exciting stuff. So I don't know how much you want to tell about it, if you want to go into too much detail, but what's it like getting followed around by the cameras and the big BBC crew?
So it's for the radio, so it's just the microphones, which, you know, whatever, maybe we've got faces for radio, I don't know, but that's fine, we'll do that. So yeah, basically they were just following, they bill it as ordinary people doing extraordinary things, and I'm like, Now, in my world, you've got that back to front. We're extraordinary people doing ordinary things because wrestling is just part and parcel of our life. But yeah, they're basically following us. They've come to training a few times. They came to the show and they kind of just followed us about and interviewed us about things. And I think the general idea is giving an insight into our journey. It's almost like we're guides into the wrestling world. Like, so, you know, our journey as trainees making their debut, but also kind of what wrestling is for those that don't know, and what could you expect, what might interest you, what kind of intrigue is there?
I think the focus very much was on, you know, the audience will be people who have either very limited understanding of wrestling or who have no understanding of wrestling. So some of our interview kind of focused on that.
Just like talking them through the basics. It's funny, you don't realise how much like, how much you know, and then you go to say something like, oh, I don't know what that means.
And you know that way, it's simple things that we'll band about, like they'll go for the pin and the person's like, I don't know what that is, can you explain that to me? And you have to sit down and explain it, because the woman who was doing the recording had no experience of wrestling, no insight or anything like that, so it very much was coming in from a blank canvas, like I had no idea. So we were having to explain these wee terms that you just take for granted because you just say them all the time when you're chatting about wrestling.
We took it to a show as well, so we were volunteering at a Chick Cullen's charity show, and we were just selling raffle tickets and things and just watching the magic happen, really. And she was there as well, and so she was kind of trying to follow us as, like, you know, trainees supporting this show, and Aisha was working on the show, and so she was kind of talking to her as well, but then she was trying to catch our reaction as fans. And it's difficult to compartmentalize that in your head, that, you know, right, you're there with Aisha, you're thinking about your training, your experience, and what, you know, how you conduct yourself, you know, and what you want people to take from you. Because, you know, like I said previously, you know, we can be Marmite and people can very easily take us the wrong way and not like us. And we're like, you know, we're not setting out to aggravate people. We just don't care if we do aggravate people along the way. But we were very mindful that, you know, we're at Chick Cullen's show, you know, and it's like that Fit Finlay in the Paisley Town Hall moment again, where you're like, oh, baby, take a back seat here, you know, be an observer, be, you know, and watch what's going on and learn from it, and find your place, find our weak spots, find where we can make a niche for ourselves, you know. And then she's asking us, all right, okay, what's a pinfall or what's a submission? And you're like, don't know where to go with this, like, don't know where to start.
Absolutely same. Face and heel. For years, I would just say good guy, bad guy, because it was a lot easier that way. And now I've gotten to the point where my wife will just say face and heel. So I'm like, oh, thank God, I don't have to play the charade anymore of things. She knows what they are. So that's fine. It is, again, it's that muggle thing where you're just going, how do people not understand this? How do people not know what a pinfall is? And they're watching and going, because we've never watched any of this. We watch,
I don't know.
I don't know what people do outside of watching wrestling.
I know.
They must have a lot of free time on their hands.
It boggles the mind, because I'm just like, what do you do? How do you spend your time? Oh, you watch, I don't know, murder documentaries or something, and I'm just sitting there just going, I just want to watch wrestling. That seems way more fun. So we will briefly mention, of course, that, of course, No Backup Required originally wasn't a Renegade Wrestling show. It was something else. Did you notice the confusion with that? I mean, I suppose you were just coming to Batterfolk regardless of the name of the show. But was there any point where you're thinking, oh, we're so close and yet it might not happen because of this? Or what was your...
I had no doubt that it would happen, because Aisha Raymond is Aisha Raymond, and she is a force of nature, and she prioritises wrestling, you know, above anything. You know, that's her focus, you know, and I think that's what resonates with us, is that wrestling is a priority. You know, it's not about, you know, it's not about appearances, or it's not about virtue signalling or anything like that. It's about wrestling. And so I had no doubt that the show would go ahead. But in the weeks leading up to it, there just did seem to be a wee bit of discontent. You could see the stress that she was taking on. You could see in what ways we were kind of limited. And, you know, and we had said, you know, if she makes a move, if she walks, if she starts, you know, something new, a new chapter in her life or a new venture, you know, we'll follow, we will go with her, we'll be behind her 100%, because we're not there for any sort of name of a company or, you know, name a renegade or anything like that. You know, we're there for the wrestling, and she is the woman that is bringing us to the dance, so to speak, and has taught us so much and given us so much and has so much faith in us that, you know, she has our loyalty. You know, and we might disagree on things, like, you know, we might fight each other down the line, or we might try, you know, nah, that's not happening, but, you know, we'll explain that to her, it's okay. But yeah, we were, you know, we were ready to go with her, to follow her where she went, and so the decision was made that Renegade Wrestling and Renegade Wrestling Dojo would be the banner that we were going into battle under, and that was fine. You know, it's all it is a like a change of name, but the action was still going to be the same.
Yeah.
And you know, she did an incredible job at pulling it together, and the show was a sellout, and it was such a positive environment for everybody to have their voice heard and have their say, you know, and be who they are, mm-hmm. and not, you know, there was no caveats or limitations in anything put on. And what you could bring to the table, you know, the only kind of the only stipulation she gives us is no fire.
I know, but we're trying to talk her round, but she doesn't seem up for it.
Yeah, but like, you know, she was just really like, it all happened quite quickly, you know, it was the same week as the show that Renegade came into existence, and so it just like, it was such a crazy
just
turnover.
A whirlwind, yeah, of action. And
everybody just jumped in. You know, and man their stations, yeah. Or women their stations, or anybody in between their stations.
Yeah, and then just rolled the sleeves up and got on with it, because it was going to happen. There was no question it was going to happen.
Yeah. So. And it's, I mean, there are so many different kind of personalities and different agendas and different views and differences, opinions within the kind of Renegade community. But we were all in agreement that we were having a show and we were backing Aisha, and we just moved with it. So. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and again, you know, we just knew that we were going to stomp on that cat, so whatever happened in between was irrelevant.
We're just going to do our job.
Yeah.
Excellent. Right, so we'll sidebar for a moment, because even though it is season 4, I'm still going to ask our two ridiculous questions that we ask everyone that are not wrestling related, depending on your mindset for it. You might think of it wrestling related when I get through it. First question for everyone, though, is what's your favourite dinosaur?
Diplodocus, thank you.
Triceratops.
Fine, two classics. And the other one, which I don't know, there might be a split opinion here. What would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow.
Oh, what are you talking about? You go for the tag team sheep?
You think that?
No, you are an idiot. You are an idiot.
Sheep love to put themselves in positions to just die.
That's true, if they get on their back.
Anything, like, they're like... You've got a field of grass and there's a field of sand over there. They'll go over there and try to eat the sand. Cow every time.
Nah. I need to go with the tag team. I need to go with the sheep. Because I'm talking about career tag team life. And I mean, we're talking about one cow. That says a lot about us, doesn't it? I prioritise tag team. You prioritise one cow.
I'm not saying that's just a question I'm asking. Then just you can have a fight about it later. And
I've got a question for you, Billy.
What?
What is the biggest mammal you could take in a fist fight?
I'm very weak, I'll be perfectly honest with you. I think I could, I don't know, I was going to say hippo, but they could kill me.
Hippos can go.
I know, yeah. I was going to say hippo, but no, they're actually terrified at the thought now. I think I could punch a cow. Is that a mammal?
Yeah.
See, I think I could take
a classic cow.
Classic, yeah.
That's,
she thinks she'd be a giraffe.
Right, because think about it, right? If you've got a giraffe, if you keep in its legs, it can't get you with its neck.
The biggest mammal I reckon I could take in a fist fight is Brody Adler.
Because
Brody Adler was on here with our new best friend Billy talking about how we're big hairies.
Yeah.
Big hairies.
I know.
And then she comes at me.
Lovely.
She comes at me on Twitter, and she's like, "Am I wrong?" And I'm like, "Oh, you're not wrong. The only issue about what you're saying is you don't realise how right you are." So we have got business to discuss in the new year, Brody Adler, big Heeries. Although she did say that we're a new breed of brutality, which I really like.
Is fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Stealing that. That's the tagline for the Struthers Sisters.
Yeah, that's us.
Speaking of Brody, we'll do her questions and then we'll start wrapping up. I don't want to take too much of your time. So I've got Brody asking, because quite a big question she's got in there. What's your ambitions and what promotions do you want to work for? And who are currently on your hit list?
I'll go with promotions that we want to work for.
Mm-hmm.
So firstly, this is just classic Brody, just misunderstanding the Struthers Sisters, because we don't work for anyone. We work for ourselves. And we are on a mission to rebrand what female tag team wrestling looks like, and we are about hard hitting, we're about taking what we want, give nothing back, we're not prioritising what we look like or what our ring wear looks like or, you know, our funny wee social media picture, whatever. That's not what we're about. We are just going to get in there, take up space, and if you don't like it, then that's on you and you're going to have to do something about it. And so any promotions that want to see what that looks like, that want to embrace the darkness, that want to have that in the show, we're happy to work with. But yeah, we're not prioritizing any one place or one destination, or, you know, we're just here to take up space and unapologetically do what we want to do, and if you don't like it, stop us.
Okay, it picks off the ambitions bit as well then, I suppose. Just come in and
who's on the hit list?
I mean, I think pretty much anyone that isn't Aisha Raymond, like, we stand beside her, not in front of her, because she is a big, terrifying woman.
Yeah.
But everyone else, fair game.
Yeah.
Why not? We're just here to cause a ruckus.
Yeah. Have some fun.
Yeah.
And with that then, I suppose, a new question at the end of these things is that, like, dream matches. So, let's say, Struthers Sisters, main event at WrestleMania, or wherever AEW's equivalent is. I'm not entirely sure because I don't watch it. All In?
All in.
Okay. Main event of All In.
All out.
I don't know.
All in, all out, full gear, whatever.
Something,
shake it all about, you know. So, main event, biggest show, WrestleMania, take them out of the equation now. Biggest show ever, you get the main event, 100,000 people are watching. Who are you facing? So, it could be anyone it's possible, so you can't throw in, of course, the Anvil or anything like that, because that's definitely not possible. But if there's a team out there, who are you facing in a dream match?
Oh, that's a hard one, because it's like you want a team that you know you can batter, but at the same time, I don't know, like, I feel like I want it to be like I want to be able to, like, drink a beer with them after, you know.
You can just say FTR if you want.
No, they hurt me. They're big, strong boys.
Big, strong women?
Aye, but, you know, terrifying. New Age Outlaws?
Yes.
New Age Outlaws.
Yeah.
100%.
Absolutely possible, because Billy Gunn looks ridiculously ripped. I mean, I don't think it's natural, but, you know, that's speculation.
It is what it is.
That's speculation, but he's ridiculously huge. And yeah. I mean, Road Dogg had the old heart attack, but I'm sure he can still get the old gear out and get the
I think we could press Road Dogg over our head.
Oh yeah, easy. I mean, like, Road Dogg's match with China, was it King of the Ring? Gender neutral person of the ring, maybe is what we should be calling it now. But yeah, 99 King of the Ring, 99 Road Dogg versus China. He's, you know, it's not a classic by any means, but it shows you the kind of man that Road Dogg is. And I like that.
So yeah, that would be it, definitely.
Yeah,
I can't believe I was speaking about all these women like Nicole Bass and Jacqueline. I didn't even think about China. That's terrible. That's awful. Because China, of course, is the archetype of the different.
But I think she's also the archetype of what could have been that was never really utilised the way that it could have been. You know, what she could have been if she was given the same time and energy, you know, as Becky Lynch or, you know, whoever the women that are about now. You know, she could have been really, you know, freakishly impressive in the best possible way. But yeah,
that's it, yeah.
So absolutely. I mean, so I've came in, I've literally got 6 lines of notes, and I'm always afraid when I come into these interviews when I've got nothing really to speak about that it's going to be 20 minutes and I'm going to run out and I'll be like, all right, what's your social handles? But no, this has been an absolutely fascinating chat. I think we could probably speak for another hour if we're speaking about Rumbles. I didn't even ask about your trips to WrestleMania, which I'm always fascinated by. But we'll leave people wanting more for the season. We'll speak to you again. So before we go then, where can people find you on social media?
So on Twitter at Maven_RWDojo. And I think you're the same, just Raven_RWDojo. We're also on Facebook, just the Struthers Sisters.
And TikTok.
TikTok, the Struthers Sisters. And then obviously you'll see all our content on RW Dojo on Twitter and Instagram.
Mm-hmm. And Facebook.
Oh, and Facebook. So we're circulating all these places. We are not necessarily the most technologically
social media savvy.
But you know, whatever. We don't need it. We just, you know, people know where to find us, and if they don't, then we will inevitably pop up in their life when we're ready to conduct our business with them.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Well, great. Well, thank you very much for joining me. It wasn't as scary as the likes of Chris Farrell that were thinking it was going to make me think it was going to be.
But I mean, Chris sometimes gets himself in the wrong place at the wrong time, you know, and you kind of maybe got yourself into dodgy situations. But I knew I'd like you, Billy. Yeah. I could just tell, you know, and I was watching your social media and I was watching your stuff on Facebook and listening to how you were talking to other people, and you're very respectful. And I like that in a person. So I was like, I knew we'd get along.
As I said, I'm very weak. I'm not going to win a fight. I'll pick my battles when I need to.
But yeah.
Thank you for speaking to me today.
Yeah, thank you very much.